Welcome to ACT Fitness Radio, the podcast teaching you to aspire, conquer, and transform your body and mind. Here's your host, Adam Castro.
All right, what's up, everybody? This is Adam. I'm here with Jaylene.
Hi.
And this is ACT Fitness Radio.
Woo!
I've been spending this week intermittent fasting. I've got a race that I might be doing this week, and I love the clarity that that I have when I fast.
The clarity or the high?
Both. The mental clarity that you get, and the nice little side effect of just feeling like you're. Like, you've got no distractions. Mm-hmm. I don't know if people think about this, but your stomach issues, the gas you might feel, the bloating, all of those can be distractions keeping you from focusing on your daily tasks.
Yeah, totally.
And I really like that when you're fasted, you really don't deal with those issues. You're not dealing with stomach pain or bloating or burping or gas or anything like that. Mm-hmm. You're just fasted.
Yeah, absolutely. And definitely more aware of... more things going on in your body.
Yes, absolutely. And I like too that once you've spent pretty much the whole day not eating, you're pretty picky about what you're putting into your body.
You should be anyway.
Yeah, you should be. You're pretty picky about what you've spent all day not putting food into your body, and you've had none of those stomach issues. And so when you're deciding what food you are going to put into your body at the end of the day, I don't want to, you know, I want to keep it that way.
Yeah,
I want to make sure I'm stomach gassy, you know, pain free. So it does keep you in check with making sure, okay, well, if I am going to put food into my body right now, is this going to give me bloating? Is this going to make me gassy? Is this going to, you know, make me have a not so good trip to the restroom? And it does dictate what you end up eating that night. So
yeah, absolutely. One of the things that I love, absolutely love the most about intermittent fasting is the glow, the skin glow that I have after I've had a good fast the next day. My skin just looks so much more clear. It looks amazing. I like it.
Well, I mean, I'm sure your skin looks a lot better without greasy food or, you know, not that all the food that you eat is greasy. It's not. But it's just other variables.
Just kidding.
It's all other variables. If you have high sugary foods or greasy foods, or even if you have the wrong sauces that you're putting in, it just happens to get on your face or whatever. It can end up causing you to break out or causing you to just not have that clean, fresh, oiled, natural oils on your face, kind of clarity in your face.
And obviously everyone's skin, you know, reacts differently to various types of foods and oils and things like that. But I swear that nothing gives your face a better glow than after you have intermittent fasted.
And bacon grease.
And you know. Bacon grease.
Yeah, if you rub
avocado
some bacon
oil
on it. Yeah. And honestly, this not just related to what upsets your stomach, and not just related to what affects the clarity of your face, but also what affects your mood, what affects your mental strength, your mental clarity. Fasting is a great way to just give yourself a clean slate. You know, give yourself a clean slate and really discover what are the foods that once you're fasted, you've been fasted for a while, like doing this not just like 2 hours. I'm talking like 14 hours, 16 hours, maybe even 24 hours. You get to now discover what foods affect you and in what ways. You get to discover what foods are going to benefit you and what foods are going to negatively affect you as you're going about your day, as you're trying to perform well, whether that's just for your everyday tasks or whether that's trying to perform well in the gym or in a sport that you're involved in.
And I would also say that intermittent fasting not only taps into everything that you just mentioned, but also your spiritual health, spiritual awareness, rather, or lack thereof.
There's a reason why in the Bible we're encouraged to fast. There's a reason why in the Bible we're encouraged to have a time of fasting, because it does bring that mental and spiritual clarity to you. You Absolutely. Don't have the distractions. You it's don't. True. You just don't have that those distractions.
Yeah, and especially if you know not eating at a consistent hour or on a consistent basis is a struggle for you, it really does force you to have a mental, emotional, and a spiritual discipline, and it takes you to a whole nother level, and it's euphoric.
Yeah, and we don't understand hunger in our culture, in American culture. We really don't understand hunger as it's meant to be understood. Hunger is when you are you have spent days without food, and your body is now running off of itself to function.
Yes,
and we don't deal with that. We have cravings. When we say we're hungry, we're not actually hungry. All we're doing is craving something. I just heard in a podcast a really good example of this. Is this father was telling his children that they needed to eat healthy food. Children were saying that they were hungry, but they wanted pizza. They wanted foods that were not healthy for them, cereal and stuff like that. And he said, no, you're going to have this food or you're not going to eat. Mm. And they were like, no, we don't want that food. We want this. Well, then they're not really hungry. You know, they're not really hungry. They're just craving a certain kind of food. And if they don't get that food, well, then they're okay with not eating.
Right.
That's not hunger. Selective eating is not hunger. Mm-hmm. It's all just craving. And so when we're put in a state of fasting, we then get to really feel that reality. And no, it's not hunger that we're feeling. It's just cravings, and we're fighting against our own desire for food, even desire for specific foods. And I think that battle is a very very important reality that we need to face.
I would even also say that the initial hunger feeling when you do actually feel that like bottomless.
Yeah, that I was giving an example. That wasn't real. That wasn't real.
No. I was like, what the hell just happened?
That wasn't real.
And cut.
Yeah, and cut. But you know when you feel that feeling of like,
yeah, that like that empty feeling, you are legitimately hungry and you want to eat. That doesn't mean you need to eat. It doesn't mean you have to eat. Now, I'm not saying, obviously, we are not saying that you should go days and days and days without eating and then finally eat so you can experience hunger for once in your life. But even getting to the point where you do have that like stomach growl, that stomach rumble, how many of us actually even feel that?
Yeah, yeah. And when your body, and it's, you know, if you are even the slightest bit overweight, if you can look at your body and grab a chunk of body fat on your body, then you have energy on your body to help you survive the day. Okay. You're not going to die if you don't eat in within a 24-hour period, but people feel that way. People honestly feel like if they don't constantly put food into their body, you get a group of unhealthy people that will think that they're going to die if they don't eat today. And you get the other group of healthier people or health-minded people who think, oh, I'm going to lose muscle if I don't eat in the next 2 hours. But it's not true.
Two extremes.
It's not true. Your body's not going to eat itself in a 24-hour period.
Something I was sharing with two of my clients the other day, I was saying that feeling, that need to eat every couple of hours or, you know, within a certain time frame in the morning or whenever it may be, I'm fully convinced that hangry feeling stems from carbs.
And yeah,
I'm not talking about fruit, although in an excessive amount of fruit can definitely give you that hangry feeling. And I'm not talking about vegetables. I'm talking about grains, you know, pasta, rice, bread, like, so much consumption of that is what gives you that hangry feeling. It's what gives you that like overwhelming, I have to eat right now or I'm gonna die feeling.
Yeah, yeah. And there's three main food groups too that carbs is a huge one. But there's three main food groupings that trigger this not only an addictive response, but an emotionally addictive response. And those are the fats, the fatty, greasy foods, the salty foods, and the sugary foods.
Yeah.
And how often, you know, I know there's a lot of people out there who may not have the same food preferences as everyone else, but when you start eating sugar, it's so easy to just keep going.
Mm-hmm.
It's so easy to just keep going. When you open up a bag of chips and they're you know, salted chips, the salt makes you want more and more and more. It's so easy to just go right through a bag.
Yeah.
Doesn't matter what size they are. Family size, you know, mini size. I remember as a kid, I would always, when they had those single serve bags, be like, that's it. That's it. Get, you know, give me like 3 to 5 of those, you know. It's a little bit more my pace, you know.
Yeah, yeah, but exactly.
But again, these are emotional foods. These mm-hmm. are emotional addictive tendencies, behavioral tendencies for you to feel comforted by this food because it tastes good, because it's easy to consume. There's not that many calories in the sugar and the salty foods.
Oh, right, right.
There's a little bit more caloric intake to fatty foods, but when it's fatty foods like hot dogs, that are so easy to just gulp down. Mm-hmm. It's too easy for you to just continue to grab the food and keep going and keep going and keep going.
And I would even say that not all, but a good majority of medical health professionals are the reason why people feel the need to eat breakfast, lunch, and dinner, or breakfast, snack, lunch, snack, dinner, snack, or anything in between any of those variations as well. We are encouraged to eat more rather than less.
Yeah, and even in our own industry, the personal training industry, it's been no secret that it's been recommended to eat the 5 meals a day. Make sure you have consistent food going into your body, you know, 20 to 40 grams of protein every meal that you have. That way you can hit your goal. And that's to keep the fire of your metabolism burning throughout the day. And that's just not the way it works.
Well, I mean, it is such a joke. It is such a joke to tell someone, okay, so to tell someone, anyone, but especially someone who is, I would say, extremely overweight or obese, to tell them you need to keep that metabolism up. First of all, their metabolism isn't up. So adding more and more food is not going to speed up their metabolism.
And since you mentioned that, I remember seeing this episode of my 600-pound life. I think it's something like that. My life as a 600-pound person or something along those lines. And this 600-pound person, very extreme end of the spectrum, right? They need to lose this weight. Otherwise, they will die. So this is very extreme. They were seeking medical help to get the surgery for them to get rid of their body fat and be able to close their stomach up to make it smaller. And in order to be a part of these surgeries, the doctors give them goals beforehand to mm-hmm. see if they're even committed to their weight loss journey.
Mm-hmm.
And so they'll tell them, okay, we will think about it once you lose your first 20 or 30 pounds. Okay, so next time you see me in a month, I want you to lose 20 pounds, or they'll give them a number and a time frame, whatever. And they struggle with it, but if they're determined, they'll start doing it. They'll be complaining the whole time. They'll feel like they're being punished. I've seen this on multiple episodes of this TV show. All of them feel like they're being punished because they can't have whatever they want, whenever they want. And then they go into the hospital. They end up losing the weight, go into the hospital, they get accepted for the treatment. And then once they get part of the treatment, they have to stay in the hospital. Okay, they have to stay in the hospital on the bed because no one's gonna pick them up and move them and walk them around, because these people are that heavy, they need assistance to move. They stay in the bed and they're given hospital food.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when I was watching these episodes, I was seeing how each and every one of them did not want the hospital food.
Mm-hmm.
They would ask their families to sneak them in junk food so that they could eat. And the doctors had to keep those family members from visiting the patient because obviously the doctor does not want the patient to be eating junk food.
Yeah.
And you see the emotional response that this patient is feeling from not getting the foods they're used to and having to live off of this hospital food for, I think it's about a week that they have to stay in the hospital. It's not that they weren't, it's not that they were so, on point with their nutrition, and it wasn't that the surgery did so much for them. I honestly believe that a lot of the success that comes from this first initial time period of when someone gets this operation done, it's because they don't want to eat the food in the hospital.
Yeah.
They're forced to fast. Right. They're forced to fast because they will not eat the hospital food, and so they end up not eating, and you know, big surprise, they don't die. They only lose the body fat that's stored on their body. And when they do eat, it's actually smaller portion. It's actually, not too much healthier, but a little healthier than what they're used to eating.
Mm-hmm.
And then they go back into the real world. And unfortunately, a lot of them end up putting back on the weight that they lost during their time in the hospital. Because what their struggle is not... their struggle is not related to so much their activity level or maybe even their commitment level. It is their emotional addiction and responses to the food that they're used to eating.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it's sad. It's sad to see.
It is exactly what you said. It is an addiction. There are, and I want to say this with compassion, and I also want to say this with understanding and hopefully reaching out to people who are either in this situation or have been in this situation or who can resonate with it, at any point in time. But we've seen people at the grocery stores who are overweight, and they're in the mobile cart thingies, the ones that you drive around.
Mm-hmm.
And they're, they weigh a good amount, and they're getting off of the seat, reaching for more junk food. It's sucking them in, and it's continuing on in this process. And I've witnessed time and time again, people in such severe conditions, and then they'll have a loved one with them who's like driving them in the cart, and there's so much wrath and anger towards this person who is helping them move around the aisles.
Always.
And go through things like that. And I want people to understand and see what you're doing to that person who's trying to help you, who may either be, who's probably not as heavy as this person, he or she may be, maybe not a whole lot less lighter, but nonetheless not as heavy as the person they're moving around. But there's no need to lash out like that. But people do that because of the addiction that they have to the food that they want so badly.
Yeah, and Jaylene was referring to a specific time we saw someone at a Walmart, and she was reaching for ice cream out of her car, or what was it, a mobile, what do you call those things?
I don't know, the mobile carts.
She was trying to lift herself up out of her cart to reach for this ice cream, which has probably put her where she is today. And it's just a very sad thing to see. It's like the addict going to the drug that has ruined their life so much, and they continue to still need the drug because that's what they're addicted to. And this person may be an amazing person inside who has goals in their life, who has the capability of achieving so much with their life. Maybe their job doesn't relate to anything physical at all, and so they are really focused on as far as success is just their mental success and what they do on a computer or whatever. Totally not discounting anything like that. But when there is something that our body is telling us, big or small, and we let it get out of hand, it only gets bigger and bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
Until the point where it's not just you who notices it, it's everybody who notices it. And overweightness and obesity is one of those things where we've just allowed these addictive behaviors to just get so out of control that now everybody knows that this is an issue that you struggle with.
And it's not fair to lash out at people who love you and who want to help you, and even those who don't love you and may not want to help you. There's still no reason to lash out at others. And obviously, there are various types of situations. You know, some people may be overweight or obese because, you know, they had knee surgery and now their knees are killing them, or you know, maybe someone doesn't have a leg or an arm or whatever the situation may be. There is never an excuse to not move.
Yeah.
You should always be able to move, be mobile to some extent. Even if you cut off one of your limbs, your body, the other parts of your body are still capable of doing stuff.
Yeah, and you need to look for these indicators. If you find that you're getting really, really tired really, really easily, then that shows that you need to start working on your cardiovascular endurance, mm-hmm. and you need to start working on your muscular strength. If you find that you're struggling to breathe well, then you know that that's something you got to focus on. And if you are at the point where you need to reach out your hand for someone to help you stand up every time you're getting up out of the chair, or you're at the point where you can't get up off the floor by yourself, or like I said, I've watched these television shows where there's people who can't get out of, who can't take a shower by themselves. They can't use the restroom by themselves. They need someone to clean them because they literally cannot move their bodies off from where they are resting.
Mm-hmm.
These are huge indicators that you need to change something in your life.
Yeah.
And that's something worth changing, and you can change it. It takes you a long time to get to that point. And I don't think anyone is going to disagree that it's going to take a very long time to get away from that point, to get you back to a healthy position. Are you going to need surgery? Maybe.
Yeah.
You know, maybe. Some damage is irreversible.
Mm-hmm.
Damage to the joints sometimes is irreversible. Damage to the skin that's stretched so far because the obesity has just gotten so out of hand, sometimes that's irreversible.
About that. Like, your body does have a capacity. Your body does have a limit. So when you stretch that skin beyond its ability, how can you expect it to go back?
Right.
Your body was not born. You did not come out of your mother's womb 500 pounds or 200 pounds or whatever. You didn't come out of the womb like that. There is again, a limit that your body cannot go past.
Right. So you do have to recognize there's consequences for the choices and behavior that you've had thus far. But these are very difficult decisions that you will have to make, and they're worth making. They're worth making because even if you feel like you've hit rock bottom and you don't know how to get back to where you were or how to get back to a better place, it is worth taking that journey, because if you can get to a better place, then you not only have the self-confidence in yourself to know that you can do that, but the strength and perseverance to be able to get you to that place is going to carry you in the future. It's going to help you to accomplish more things in the future. It's going to help you to recognize the strength that you have as a person overall to accomplish whatever you're trying to accomplish.
And this applies to everyone all over the spectrum. Kids, elderly, and everybody in between. Absolutely everybody in between. This is completely applicable. And I understand that there are some elderly who are actually incapable of sitting down and standing up and things like that. But see all of those as examples. If you don't start doing those things consistently before you get to that place, then that's what happens.
Yeah, and we're not saying everyone has to intermittent fast.
No.
We're not saying that. If you're overweight, we're not saying to starve yourself for those 3 days or so that you can burn the body fat or anything like that. No, because at the end of the day, it's not going to be these 3 days that are going to get you to full health. It's going to be the habits that you set in place to allow you to see that long-term success. I don't think that I would discourage anyone from taking a period of time of just staying away from food just for the sake of understanding what a craving feels like and to just call it what it is. And so if that's 2 hours for you If you literally eat food every second of the day and you need to spend 2 hours away from food, well, then that's where you're at.
Yeah.
Just
yeah,
so you can
absolutely.
Recognize.
Baby steps.
Yeah, baby steps. Just so you can recognize how unhealthy that addiction and emotional attachment to the food is. But if you're someone who, you know, does eat every 2 hours and thinks that you're not addicted to certain foods, I would encourage you to try to do those 14-hour, 16 or 24-hour mm-hmm. fasts just to see what, when you're in that state, what foods do you cling to or what foods do you think of? What foods do you crave? And that way you understand where those emotional attachments lie.
Take this as encouragement, please. If you are in the situation yourself, if you find yourself in this situation, please be encouraged. If you know anyone else who may be in this situation, please share this episode with them and know that, you know, no one is alone. I guarantee you that there are so many people around you, us included, who want to help you, who know that you can do it. We're all going through a journey, all of us.
Yeah, and we started this podcast by basically talking about intermittent fasting. This isn't something we do all the time.
Yeah, yeah.
Fasting is not something we do all the time because it's a dance. It's a mm-hmm. dance. Sometimes we do it, sometimes we don't. Sometimes our body needs it mm-hmm. and sometimes it doesn't.
Right.
You know, if I'm trying to really focus on building maximal strength and I do want those calories to be coming in on a regular basis throughout the day, well then I'm going to do that. Mm-hmm. If my goal is not towards that and I just want that clarity and to just focus on better awareness of what's going into my body and what to do with my body, well, then I'm going to go ahead and spend some time playing around with intermittent fasting. You have to understand where you fall in that dance. What foods are going to be healthy for you? What type of exercise are you going to be comfortable with doing? What can you even do right now? Is walking an exercise for you? Or do you need to push yourself to do something more? Do you need to start small? Do you need to start big? You know, these are all questions that you should be asking yourself to make sure that you are constantly progressing, that you are constantly examining your own journey when it comes to physical health, mental health, spiritual health, and relational health. It's not just you who's affected by all these things. It's your family. It's your friends. It's your coworkers. It's the people that you're in contact with. We talked about those loved ones who want to help you when you're struggling.
Yeah.
You know, love them. Mm-hmm. Love them by taking care mm-hmm. of yourself and not neglecting these aspects of your body mm-hmm. and yeah. of your mind and of your soul.
Absolutely.
Man, this has been a deep podcast. Oh man. And this is the journey that we're all on. Some of us are, you know, around 150 pounds or 180 pounds, just trying to lose a little bit of weight and gain a little bit of strength.
Yeah.
And some of you are in that 250 to 300 pounds who feel lost, not knowing what to do or where to go. And we understand that. And we definitely want to be there to help. So before we keep going with this podcast, I do want to let you know that you can always reach out to us on our website.
Absolutely.
ACTFitnessAcademy.com.
Yep.
You can reach out to us on our Instagram, which is at ACTFitnessAcademy. Mm-hmm. And ask us questions. Ask us questions, because we would love to connect with you and encourage you on this journey. The people who are struggling with those addictions or with that behavior or just struggling with where they're at, period. Those are the kind of people that we have a passion for and that we want to help. And if that's you, then definitely reach out to us so that we can do that.
Yes, please, please don't be shy. Definitely reach out to us.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. So we're going to go ahead and end this podcast with our workouts of the week to give you an example of what we've been doing this week to make sure that we stay physically fit. I'll go ahead and start with mine. we changed the place that we end up running in the trails.
Yes, we did.
Woo! It had been raining a lot this past week, as I mentioned in the last episode.
it hasn't changed.
No, it hadn't changed.
In case you were wondering.
So the trails we normally run in were closed, so we had to find a different place to run. Mm-hmm. Luckily, there's a park that's not too far away, Shabaram Park, and we decided to go run in that area. And I totally forgot, because I was in cross country for one semester, and I did do I was in cross country for one semester. It wasn't amazing. It wasn't the worst. Wasn't the best at all, but. But I totally forgot that we had a race over in Shabaram Park, and it was a trail race, and it was actually a very difficult run, that I loved and totally just ended up forgetting about. So for the, first time in, I think that was my senior year in high school. So it had to have been 6 years or so. 6 or 7 years since I had been there, and the first time in 6 or 7 years, we went to those trails, and I was able to run about 3 miles up in those trails, and it was absolutely brutal.
Yeah, it was absolutely
brutal. The really
sucked.
Yeah, the really cool thing about those trails is that unlike the trails I'm used to running, which kind of has a general flat terrain with a little bit of uphill, a little bit of downhill, a little bit of uphill, a little bit of downhill, this terrain was all uphill going into the first mile and a half, and then I decided to just turn around and go downhill. So it's all uphill, all downhill, and I think it's about a 400 foot difference between the bottom and the top. So it was a lot of fun. It allowed me to really work on my technique with running uphill, and then after that to focus on my technique running downhill.
Yeah, so, and this guy didn't want to keep going back to that trail, but I said that we should keep going back to that trail. I encouraged him. You're welcome.
Yeah, so that, and it is a little bit more like the Spartan race, because Spartan races are merciless when it comes to hills.
Yeah.
So I do need to focus in that specific area of running on my uphill running and downhill running.
Yeah, I think it was just, for that reason, it was just a great idea for us to continuously go back to those hills and practice, practice, practice.
Yep.
So my favorite workout of the week, it's nothing too crazy, it's not super exciting, I'm sorry, but it is deadlifting. I deadlifted a lot this week.
Yeah.
A lot for me. Anyway. But the one thing that I really, really love about deadlifting is that there's always something to improve. I feel like I'm always learning. Even though I know how my form should be, I know where my feet should be, all of those things, we are imperfect beings and we forget, and we also may, you know, discover new things about our body that we hadn't discovered before, which that's definitely me. That's definitely how I feel. So I just love that the deadlift is challenging in very many ways.
Yeah. And, one of the really cool things about being in fitness for so long is that you're constantly, constantly, constantly learning. It really doesn't even matter how long you've been working out. Mm-hmm. And as trainers, like we go through this all the time when we are constantly researching and, allowing mentors or just other fitness influencers to pour into us. We learn new things about ourselves, and we do our very best to make sure that always bleeds into those that we are an influence over. Because no one influencer can reach everyone.
Absolutely.
And and we take it as our own passion to make sure that everything we learn, in every way that we grow, that we try to allow our clients, those who follow us on our social media pages, those who interact with us, that we do our best to just share all of that knowledge and information that we've taken in.
Yeah, absolutely. And you can definitely, you know, learn from various workouts. It's obviously not just the deadlift, but the reason why I mentioned that primarily was because since I do have scoliosis, it's more of a challenge for me, right? But I was able to lift more and more weight each time, so I'm getting stronger. That's nice.
Oh yeah, getting stronger is what it's all about.
Yeah, yeah.
So, all right, we're going to be heading out. And so, again, reach out to us, go visit our website, ACTFitnessAcademy.com. Visit our Instagram page at ACTFitnessAcademy. On our website, we've got a free quiz there, and I haven't mentioned it in these last couple podcasts, but go ahead and go to the website and scroll down just a little bit. You'll see that free quiz, and if you haven't taken it, go ahead and take it. You're going to get some awesome information there.
Do it.
And test your fitness knowledge. Reach out to us, and if you haven't already done so, subscribe to this podcast and leave us a 5-star rating and review if you like what you hear. Take care, you guys.
Bye.